He was a thinker, an educator, a politician, a legend. His life's work realized the loftiest ideals of ancient Chinese scholars: to ordain conscience for heaven and earth, to secure the lives and fortune of the people, to continue the teachings of past sages, and to establish peace. Later scholars praised him as a sage. Both a general and a teacher, he lived simply, advocating learning that was sound in theory and in practice, and promoting self-government, orderly family life, secure government, and a general peace. He was one of the great Confucian thinkers. He founded a school that sent a wave of Confucianism through the Ming Dynasty and had a profound impact on generations of intellectuals. He was one young Ming, and his learning of the heart-mind had a far-reaching significance in Chinese thought. When he was 15 or 16, Wang Yangming had an aspiring mind. Though he was so young, he was determined to grasp the true meaning of Chengzhu Neo-Confucianism, a goal that most Confucian scholars since the Song Dynasty had spent their whole lives pursuing. The first thing that Wang Yangming did was investigate Bang Bu. Zhu Xi, the master of Neo-Confucianism in the Song Dynasty, had advocated finding the heavenly principle through investigating material things. The heavenly principle that all things had in common could be found only by Ge Wu, investigating things. A scholar should study one thing today and another tomorrow. After accumulating the theories of several specific things, he might be suddenly enlightened and realize that everything manifests the heavenly principle. Wang Yangming set out to find the heavenly principle in a bamboo grove in the back garden of his father's government office. Like an aged monk, he quietly studied the bamboo in front of him, feeling and observing every changing detail. For 7 days, he neither ate nor slept. He was waiting for the sudden awakening. In the end, the bamboo no longer seemed to be the same grove he had first looked at. His head began to spin. Wang Yangming's intense contemplation was making him ill. He failed to find the heavenly principle by investigating bamboo.
He asked his father, 当然，到了阳明的心里面，圣人是什么，很难说，就是说第一等人，这是他的志向。Wang
Yangming was born Wang Xiaoren. His ancestry could be traced back 1,000 years to an aristocratic family in the Eastern Jin Dynasty. His father, Wang Hua, topped the imperial examination of 1481. Commissioned by the Imperial Academy to write books, he became a literary courtier for the emperor. Wang Yangming showed early promise. At 10 years old, he improvised a poem, The Moon-Shading Mountain House. This mountain makes the moon look small, so we think it bigger than the moon. But if someone had an eye as wide as heaven, he would see a small mountain and a big moon. Its freestyle and unconventional vision demonstrated his perceptiveness and depth of thought. Wenyang Ming wrote verse throughout his life, and his complete works include more than 600 poems. 40 manuscripts of his poems have been found that also prove his skill in calligraphy. The manuscripts are eagerly sought after across the world. The calligraphy follows ancient rules, but shows some innovation. The style is elegant but straightforward, reflecting the author's moral attitude and philosophy of life. Wenyang Ming left his hometown, Yuyao, at the age of 11 and followed his father to the capital. There he was able to read many Confucian classics. Inspired by the Confucian ideals of cultivating oneself, bringing order to the family, governing the country, and bringing peace to all, he was eager to explore the true meaning of things and to discover the world around him. He embarked on his next project. This time he traveled to the Great Wall and visited the three inner passes in Hebei province. There was frequent fighting on the northwest frontier at the time. He asked about the activities of the border tribes and the defensive strategies that the local people adopted. Observing the mountains and rivers and the Great Wall stretching for thousands of miles, he felt inspired. It became his dream to make a great contribution to his country. A month after journeying to the frontier, Wenyang Ming returned home to the relief of his family. But matters were far from settled for the young man. A Chinese saying praises heroes from youngsters. Yang Ming, now full of lofty ideas, wrote a letter for the emperor, suggesting a defensive strategy to pacify bandits. He had all the idealism of youth, and he solemnly presented the letter to his father, asking him to take it to the emperor. Instead, he received a severe reprimand. His father was furious and rebuked him for his arrogance. But the rebuke did not make him give up. He studied the art of war and collected peach stones at family dinners to practice organizing troops. All day long, he would talk about his plans till his father suggested that he should get married to settle his restless mind. In 1488, the first year of the Hongzhou Emperor of the Ming Dynasty, Wenyang Ming went to Nongchang to get married on his father's orders. But the young man still had an endless thirst for knowledge. He wanted to understand the inner world. He didn't need the shackles of marriage. He needed a mentor to give him direction. In 1489, he took his wife back to his hometown in Zhejiang province. While passing through Shangrao in Jiangxi province, he decided to pay a special visit to a famous Neo-Confucian scholar, Lo Liang. He came to play a vital role in Wenyang Ming's life and soon became his spiritual mentor. Lo Liang guided him towards the right path.
Lo Liang said, 这是居经之门，这是入门的基本方法。第二句话，以何事何虑，父王、父祖为居经要旨，是什么意思呢？就是你不要有各种各样执念，这种思虑，那种思虑，不要有各种执念，也不要依靠外界来帮助你提高道德品质修养。
But the lofty ambition to be a sage could not solve the practical problems of Wenyang Ming's life. The only way to contribute to the administration of the state was to become an official. And for that, you needed to take the imperial examination. When he was 19, his father told him to prepare for the imperial examination. To do this, he needed to study the classic texts of Chengdu Neo-Confucianism. In the Ming Dynasty, scholars were ranked by their mastery of ancient works, and the imperial examination was based on the four books and the five classics. In the early Ming Dynasty, Zhu Xi's was the standard interpretation of these works. Some scholars even believed that his extensive and detailed works, such as the collected commentaries on the four books, covered the thought of the ancient sages so comprehensively that later generations only needed to examine Zhu Xi's teaching and follow it step by step.
In the Ming time, the most influential one is Zhu Xi, Zhu's teaching, because through the academic exam, Zhu Xi.有个基本的，这个朱学我们叫建教，就是佛教里面有顿教和建教，它是一个逐渐，就是逐渐的积累你的知识，然后积累的知识以后，先知后行，你先有知识，积累了知识，然后另外多半人都准备科举，就跟我们现在一样准备高考，那么你要读很多书，你要背很多的这个，要记忆很多的文本。然后呢，学做人，战战兢兢，一步一趋，按照一个规定来做。
So Wan Yangming began to prepare for the imperial examination. 10 years later, at the age of 28, he passed the Jinshi, the highest level. Finally, he began a career as an official, as his father had wished.Initially.He was sent to the Ministry of Works as an assistant. But at that time, there were still many battles on the northwest frontier. The court sought advice. Wan Yangming had continued to pay close attention to the situation on the frontier. So he was able to write to the emperor on the topic, as he had wanted to do at the age of 15.He recommended 8 measures for frontier defense, including stockpiling supplies for emergencies, reducing troop numbers to save money, using garrison soldiers to cultivate wasteland for food, and applying just laws to gain prestige for the court. His decade of preparation made this advice very pertinent. Unfortunately, on this occasion, he received no reply.The court officials wanted to stick to precedent. The whole bureaucracy was stagnant. Chengdu Neo-Confucianism had not only failed to revitalize government in the Ming Dynasty, it had actually made it more rigid. Wan Yangming was now 30, and he felt that he had accomplished nothing. The values inherited from the past were collapsing, and he found it impossible to implement his own ideas.He grew very depressed. Yangming Cave, a Taoist retreat since ancient times, is at the southern foot of Wanwei Mountain, 6 kilometers from the city of Shaoxing in Zhejiang Province. In 1502, Wan Yangming returned to his hometown to recover from an illness. He built an abode beside the cave.And temporarily forgot Chengdu Confucianism, national affairs, and his family. Nor did he take an interest in the beautiful landscape. Rather, he meditated, trying to cure his spiritual crisis through Buddhism. He sat motionless and reflected upon the problems of life that had puzzled him for 30 years. In Yangming Cave, many things came into his mind.Archery and military learning, though practical, were in the end of no fundamental value. Buddhist meditation delighted his mind, but it distanced him from his father and grandmother who had raised him. One day it came to him that his feelings for his loved ones were inborn. It is the nature of human beings to feel such affection. It is the foundation of being a human being. If we cut off the natural affection of the child, it destroys our humanity. So in seeking immortality through meditation alone, we are abandoning our responsibilities. Self-realization must take account of universal human sentiments.
假如我祖母这一年能忘，我还是不是一个人？那么这是一个儒家和其他的学术中间最关键的一个课题。儒家的思想是入世，就是说有一些情不仅不能忘，不能切断，而且是你之所以作为人的必要条件。
For Wan Yang Ming, the cave became more than a place of self-realization. It was the place where he renounced Buddhism and returned to Confucianism. Before leaving the cave, he made a bold decision. He would return to the theories of Confucius and Mencius, but he would reject the rules of Chengdu Neo-Confucianism. He would begin to break its hold on people's minds and teach them to take a path of their own.His time in the cave transformed his thinking and led to a huge change in his life.
要出来建功立业，必须是走在儒家的这条金光大道上，那是别无选择的。所以他为他说，练完以后，他觉得那个拨弄精神没有意义，就是这个要想不朽，就立功立言立德。
1505 was an important year for Wan Yang Ming. At the age of 34, he was promoted to head the Ministry of War. He also began giving lectures on his philosophical views. During this period, he met a fellow Neo-Confucian, Zhan Roshui, and they became close friends. Zhan Roshui's teacher, Chen Baisha,was a famous Neo-Confucian who helped open up philosophy in the early Ming Dynasty. He advocated abandoning books and instead writing, listening, and thinking in silence. His ideas corresponded with Wan Yang Ming's. Wan Yang Ming now found a new direction. He and Zhan Roshui exchanged ideas,hoping to open up a new philosophical world outside mainstream circles. But to transcend Chengdu Neo-Confucianism, Wan Yang Ming still had a huge mountain to climb, namely himself. After the death of Emperor Shaozong, Emperor Wuzong succeeded to the throne at the age of 15. The new emperor favored eunuchs such as Liu Qin, and to monopolize power,they began attacking honest ministers. As a result, most of the ministers resigned. When imperial officers such as Dai Shi raised objections, they were arrested. Wan Yang Ming, who was in charge of the Ministry of War, faced two choices, to play it safe or to speak out. Choosing the former would protect his official career, while choosing the latter would definitely lead to prison.Should he be pragmatic, or should he follow the guidance of his heart? Wan Yang Ming was caught in a dilemma between knowledge and action. He realized that to follow the doctrine of Confucius and Mencius meant he must be honest. Morality could only become true through action. This was the unambiguous responsibility of all scholar officials. Wan Yang Ming decided to risk his life by publicly objecting.He suggested that the imperial officials should be forgiven. Liu Jin was furious and threw him into prison. He was mercilessly flogged and did not recover for a long time. Wan Yang Ming was not killed, but he was demoted to the humble position of post-house supervisor at Lungcheng in remote Guizhou. His banishment there proved extremely difficult.In the spring of 1508, Wan Yang Ming set out on the road to Lungcheng. It was a dangerous route. Lungcheng post house lay in the mountain forests of northwest Guizhou. It was very small, with only one postal official and a single clerk. When he first arrived, there wasn't even a place for him to stay. So he had to build a hut to live in. But his hut couldn't keep up the wind and rain, so he moved to a cave in Dongfang and called it the Yangming Cave. This Yangming Cave was located on Lungang Mountain in the east of Guizhou's Shuwen County. Today, the cave has 45 inscriptions from the Ming, Qing, and Republic of China periods, more than anywhere else in the world. They express reverence for Wang Yangming, or sympathize with his tribulations, or pay tribute to his school of the heart mind. During the Ming Dynasty, the Longcheng region was full of poisonous snakes, scorpions, and other dangers. It was difficult to communicate, since most of the local people were indigenous Miao or Yi, who only spoke their own languages. The only people that Wang Yangming could talk to were Han bandits who had taken refuge there. But this hostile place became Wang Yangming's spiritual home. He lived in poverty, but rose above the harsh environment. He always remained optimistic. Once he'd found the cave, he lived in it day and night, meditating on life to understand life and death.
假如是一个儒者，你在一个一无所有，任何人际关系都没有，你只下自己个人，那你还能够做儒者？就在那个时候，他的顿悟叫做无性自足，就是我的性就作为一个人，我就圆满。可是这个顿悟和佛教或者道家那种顿悟啊，或者突然彻悟、有很大的不同的。他第一个就把他所背下来的五经，他重新在的脑筋里面过一遍，叫五经一说嘛。就是我现在这样的一个感觉，这种无性自足的这种感觉，和我这个念的儒家的基本的经典有没有矛盾？他经过这五经的这个检验以后，他觉得没有矛盾，所以后来才发展出来他那一套心学，就儒家的心学。
Should Wang Yangming look to external things, or look within himself? Did self-respect come from confronting external challenges, or from the heart? He sat in the cave day and night, and eventually he found inner peace. After a long period of meditation, Wang Yangming cried out in the middle of the night, as if responding to someone talking to him in a dream. He had finally found a satisfactory answer to the problem that had troubled him for so long, of seeking the heavenly principle from investigating things. The answer was, mind shapes the world.
那么心即理呢，从这个陆象山开始，因为性即理，这是所有的只要是从事这个宋明儒学研究的人啊都接受的。那个荀子不接受，这是孟子的学说，就性，我们人性本身它是体现了这个人的本质，这个本质就是理。如果用这个孟子的学说讲，这个本质就是你的四端，恻隐、羞恶、慈当、这个是非。这个所谓心的话，就是每一个人他都有一种内在的，不是受到外面的这个影响，内在的一种同情感，内在的一种是非标准，内在的一种慈纳，内在一种修悟。
This awakening at Longcheng was the beginning of Wang Yangming's construction of the theory of the heart mind. After that, his thought spread with irresistible force. His ideas quickly transformed what had been the orthodox principles of Confucianism since Zhu Xi.When Wang Yangming considered things from the perspective of mind shapes the world, he found a new world of meaning. The problems that had puzzled him as a teenager examining bamboo were suddenly solved. His living conditions also improved. The local people erected several buildings for him to live and teach in. Lungang Academy, Herlo Pavilion,Junzi Pavilion, and Wanyi House. Lungang Academy subsequently suffered some modern renovation, but its original appearance has now been restored. It has always been regarded as a place of holy learning because Wang Yang Ming taught there. News of Wang Yang Ming's teaching at Longchang soon spread to the provincial capital. Xi Xu, the vice commissioner of education in Guizhou, personally invited Wang to teach at Guiyang Academy. Feeling that the people of his time were immersed in classical knowledge but didn't bring it into their daily lives, Wang Yang Ming now advanced his doctrine of the unity of knowledge and action. He believed that knowledge and practice had been divorced from each other, so that people were burying themselves in book learning while ignoring the importance of practical action.
Yang Ming 就说，如果自己要孝，那我没有行孝是不可能的。我那个知要知孝的那个知的本身，就意味着我一定要把它付诸实施。这个他认为是知行的本来的面貌。就知呢，就是一种明觉精察，就是你知道应该怎么样做。那么行呢，就是落实你这个明觉精察的本身。那么所以这个中间它的关系是不可分的。
Wang Yang Ming's theory of the hard mind and his doctrine of the unity of knowledge and action had little influence at first. His teachings were confined to a small area in Guizhou, and the theoretical system of the school of the hard mind was not mature and still needed some refinement.
Wang 学是在理学的基础上的一个发展，但是呢，王学里边包含了一定的，我个人认为啊，它有一定的反理学的一些东西，因为它宣称个性，是吧？它要抒发个人的这些东西，那和那个理学的那个东西克己复礼，要要求约束自己，让自己这个一切就遵从这个最传统的这规矩去办，那显然是中间是互相是有不同的。
This monument was erected at Longgang Academy.After Wang Yang Ming's time. It's engraved with poems he wrote while he was there. Longgang Mountain is very ancient and very famous, but in this heart, how can I compare myself to strategists like Guan Zhong and Ye Li, since no mountain folk understand the ancient music? The desert has made birds extinct. The grass and trees rustle like an army. Best to learn from hermits here.And go to the mountains to collect herbs. The poem depicts Wang Yang Ming's desolation at his exile and his inability to realize his ambitions and ideals. A leisurely life in seclusion was not for him. Fortunately, he did not have to stay in Longcheng for much longer. He was promoted 3 times in 1 year.In 1516, at the age of 45, Wang Yang Ming was appointed assistant censor owing to bandit activity in Jiangxi. He became circuit inspector in Jiangxi and Fujian, then took charge of military affairs in southern Jiangxi and western Fujian. From February 1517, Wang Yang Ming commanded successive battles at Jiangnan, Hangshui, Tunggang, and Liantung.In just over a year, he put down the bandits in Jiangxi, Fujian, and other places. But he realized that to govern the country properly, one must first govern hearts. For it's easier to break bandits in the mountains than to break them in the heart. These bandits had once been close to the villages. What was it in village life that had changed them from being kind and upright to being vicious and immoral?Did their hearts still harbor a conscience? Could they return to their original moral nature?
包家法，原来这个明朝最早，他对基层的管理是礼甲，礼甲更重于赋税，保甲更重于治安，是吧？他用了这样的一种形式，把整个的基层社会管理起来了，然后又用这个乡约的形式，把人们的思想改变过来，就是灭心中贼。胜于灭山中贼，他这套思想，他能够贯彻到他的所有的施政的这个工作和活动中间去。
Jiangxi province could now be considered Wanyang Ming's second home. He had married his wife in Nancheng and met his spiritual mentor, Lo Liang, in Shangrao. Most importantly, his school of the heart mind came to maturity in Jiangxi as well. On the 14th of June, 1519, shortly after Wanyang Ming had pacified the bandits, Juqin Hao, the Prince of Ning, assembled his troops in Nancheng and began an uprising to usurp the throne. He was the great-grandson of Juquan, the 17th son of the founding Ming Emperor Zhu Yanzheng. Wanyang Ming now demonstrated his military talents to the full by confronting this threat. With the help of a temporary army of 20 to 30,000 troops, he quelled the rebellion in less than 40 days. But after the victory, he had paused to reflect. Juqin Hao's wife was the granddaughter of Lo Liang, Wang's spiritual mentor back when he was 17. The Nancheng Painting Academy, formerly called the Water Guanyin Pavilion, was the palace of the Prince of Ning, and his wife, Consort Lo, lived there. It has undergone constant change over the centuries, but its layout, style, and artifacts are well preserved. Many artifacts related to Consort Lo, such as the Well of the Consort and a range of stone tablets, remain at the academy. Lo herself is said to have written the character on this huge stone tablet in moss for the prince. Before the prince went to fight, his wife tried to dissuade him. When he was defeated, she wrapped herself in white brocade and threw herself into the water to drown. But Juqin Hao was taken alive. Wishing that he'd listened to his wife, he asked Wanyang Ming to give her a proper burial. After putting down the rebellion, Wanyang Ming began thinking about good and evil. He reflected that regardless of who wins or loses, all combatants have one thing in common, and that is conscience. But conscience must be acted on, otherwise it is merely a hidden moral principle. Wanyang Ming now proposed a theory of inducing by conscience to enrich his philosophy of the heart-mind. He had devised the heart-mind theory, and he had emphasized the unity of knowledge and action. But the knowledge of the heart was still divided from external action, hence the need to induce by conscience. He claimed that this concept came to him after he had witnessed the horrors of battle. He concluded that the only way to build a better and more harmonious society was to awaken the conscience in everyone's heart and make everyone a sage.
致良知很难了解。孟子里面所谓的良知良能，就是不学而知，这个不学而能，也就是我们自己的性善所体现的四端嘛。因为恻隐啊、羞恶啊、慈让啊、是非啊，这些都我们原来具有的。但阳明的重大的贡献，就把这样一个一般讲起来是道德实践、道德哲学里面的一个范畴，变成了整个认识论和这个本体论的一个最核心的价值和观念。怎么说呢？就是天地万物都是气，这是中国的老传统。这个气就是良知良能的一种显现。所以这个良知良能不是就是人有，这个动物有，植物有，无生物都有。
This is Wanyang Ming's residence at the northern foot of Lungchen Mountain in Zhejiang Province. The large building is complete and incorporates a fine courtyard without losing any dignity or elegance. The celebrated plaque of the Three Immortal Deeds by the modern calligrapher Jiang Dongshu is in Shoshan Hall. It summarizes the three leading aspects of Wanyang Ming's life: honor, philosophy, and morality. In October 1521, Wang Yangming was created Earl of Xinjiang for his service in suppressing the Prince of Ning's rebellion. His career was prospering, but he was determined to give it up. In August, he returned to his hometown, Shaoxing. There, over the next 6 years, he devoted himself to teaching and reached the peak of his philosophy. Scholars from all over the country came to study with him, and even the most venerable men honored him as their master. These students surrounded his residence playing music and singing poems from morning till night.
家事国事天下事，事事关心的那个思想，当然跟阳明心学的关系很密切了。风声雨声，读书声声声入耳那种思想，也就是说，每一个人，都应该独立自主。所以是从己所不欲，勿施于人的基本原则，变成己利利人，己达达人。如果这个社会己利利人，己达达人多，这个社会就祥和，这个、社会就仁。
The ancients are like people's hearts.They remain essentially unchanged. But Wang Yangming's doctrine of conscience fundamentally reshaped Confucianism. From the 16th century to the late 17th century, his philosophy spread throughout China and dominated Chinese thought. His doctrines have been praised by modern scholars such as Gong Zhejian, Wei Yuan, Kang Youwei, Tan Zetong, Liang Qichao, Liang Shuming, Xiong Sheli,He Lin, and Zhang Junmai. The influence of the school of the heart-mind has reached Europe and America. It has shaped philosophical research all over the world, especially in East and Southeast Asia. The early 20th century scholars Zhang Taiyuan and Lang Qichao both emphasized its influence in Japan, notably on the modernizing leaders of the Meiji Restoration.
幕府以来的以朱熹学问为主的日本的这个学术传统一个重要的冲击。日本的现代化之所以发展，是打破了这个朱熹所代表的一个制度非常严格、礼俗非常全面的一种架构，开发出他的这个创造的力量啊，这就是阳明学所代表。
The School of the Heart Mind.Also began a cultural shift towards respecting human nature and promoting individual liberation and the courage to express oneself in the middle and late Ming Dynasty. The expansion and popularization of Wang Yangming's theory influenced artists in the late Ming and early Qing dynasties, producing greater diversity in their work.In Exalted Gathering in the Green Woods by Dong Qichang, a famous painter of the late Ming Dynasty, the figures are peaceful, comfortable, free, and alive. The School of the Heart Mind directly influenced the artist's expression. Xu Wei's Plants and Blooming Flowers, a creative image of the unity of knowledge and action,is another artistic expression of this personal liberation.
我觉得它是一个很典型的一个儒家思想，因为一大儒嘛，是吧？一代大儒，而且是新儒家，啊，但是呢，儒家并不是书呆子，并不是说坐在书斋里边读书的人，而是呢经世致用。我要把我学的东西能够为这个社会服务，为国家服务。他是这样的一个人才。
Wang Yangming really lived the principles of the School of the Heart Mind. But just when he thought he could spend his remaining years teaching, the imperial court sent him to Guangxi to quell another rebellion. Though aged 56, he had no choice but to go. When he was about to leave, his students asked him, what was the purpose of learning? He answered,In the original mind, there is no distinction between good and evil. The distinction arises when the will becomes active. Knowing good and evil is an innate faculty. Investigating things allows us to do good and banish evil. In these four sentences, he combined the wisdom of Confucianism, Buddhism, and Taoism. They combined the social care and moral obligation of Confucianism with inner peace and transcendence. The fusion of consciousness with the external world is the ultimate insight of Wang Yangming's School of the Heart Mind. On the 9th of January 1529, while on his way home after pacifying the rebellion, the 57-year-old Wang Yangming died of illness in Qinglongpu in Nan'an Prefecture, Jiangxi Province. As he lay dying, a student asked for his last words. Wang replied, "The mind is luminous and bright. What more is there to say? Indeed, it is only when one's heart is clear and bright that one can see beyond life and death and own the inner light." Like the noble spirit of Mencius, the light of Wang Yangming has inspired every succeeding generation. A Confucian passed away, but a saint was born.